Welcome to the Myopia Symposium in Argentina. First of all, I will thank Professor Bill Stell from the University of Calgary in the Cummings School of Medicine, Canada, for his help in organizing this since 6 to 7 months ago. Then Professor Calvin Pang from the Chinese University of Hong Kong in Hong Kong, who has helped us a lot in organizing this. Then Professor Andrei Grichowski from the University of Warmia and Mazuri in Austin, Poland, a very good friend since he came to Argentina about 5 years ago, with whom I've published many things, and he has helped us a lot in organizing this. And a special thanks to Professor Carlos Kotlik from the National University of Cuyo in Mendoza, Argentina, that with his energy and his effort has made this possible. I would like to thank these ophthalmological associations from my country who have given support for this event. And of course, thanks for the industry that collaborated with the Argentinian Council of Ophthalmology for the projection of this symposium. The Argentinian Council of Ophthalmology gave the know-how to make this possible, so special thanks for his president, my friend Pablo Laponte. I must say that I have nothing to declare, still involved in independent research mainly for pleasure without funding or commercial interest. I will now introduce my young friend here, Ignacio Magneto, who is resident in IOFA, Buenos Aires, in ophthalmology, but was born in Marcos Juarez, a small city in the central part of the Pampa Plains where soy, millet, and wheat are grown. We will speak about myopia in Argentina. Our myopia prevalence is low, as was shown in 2 studies we performed in adults, one based on office workers, showing about 30% prevalence of myopia in university office workers, and the other population base near Marcos Juarez in Villa Maria City, where the prevalence was less than 40%. And it's interesting that in both locations in Argentina, the prevalence of high myopia was less than 2%, probably genetic high myopia. As you see, in Latin America, from Chile to Paraguay and Brazil, the prevalence of myopia in 14 years old children is very low, under 10%. And we have 3 studies in preparation, 1 in Ecuador and 2 in Argentina, that show prevalence less than 4% in 12 to 15 year old children. Here are the pictures of the clubhouses in the city of Marcos Juarez. Ignacio, please tell us about your school life where you were born.
Hi everyone, I was born in Marcos Juarez, a small city located in the southeast of Córdoba province in the middle of the country. It has about 20,000 inhabitants. Children used to spend 5 hours per day at school, and generally most of them used to practice sports at any of the sporting clubs or parks of the city. That means at least 3 hours with outdoors exposure. We have mostly sunny days that allows us to practice many activities in green places.
Well, the point is that Omar Magneto, Ignacio's father, is also an ophthalmologist. And he has been screening in Marcos Juarez, with cycloplegia, all children entering first grade since 1995. They know that the prevalence of myopia in this age 6 children is very low, about 2%. Then Ignacio came back 5 years later when he was about to be receiving his diploma of medical doctor and studied prospectively about 300 children again with cycloplegia, showing a 5-year incidence of myopia of only 1.5%. This contrasts with the 50% incidence for 5 years in Chinese studies. But most interestingly, Marcos Juarez children showed a loss of physiological hyperopia and clustering of refractions between age 6 and 12, as you can see in this beautiful figure we have produced with his data. This is under preparation for publication. We now leave Córdoba province and come to Buenos Aires City, a developed urban environment where the prevalence of high myopia, as we have said, is low as 1 to 2%. During the last 10 years near the obelisk, the emission of 7,000 visual disability certificates studied in the Santa Lucia Hospital, 10 squares from this central point by my friend Pablo Franco, shows that in working age, the myopic maculopathy produced by high myopia is the leading cause of visual disability certificate emission. Here we see the same in another figure where vision impairment is produced mainly by myopic maculopathy and then by retinitis pigmentosa and later by glaucoma or age-related macular degeneration in working age population. When they get older, of course, AMD is the leading cause. What would be this figure in Asia in 10 years? Something needs urgently to be done to avoid this visual disability by myopic maculopathy produced by high myopia. Here are some of my friends who are independently studying myopia in the region and in Ecuador, who were mentioned in this presentation. And here, my brother Guillermo, past president of the Retina Vitreous Argentine Society, and our team of friends working together in our office. And last of all, here a figure of Picasso made by Guido, my younger son, in 1995, when I went to the first Arbo, that gave me the possibility of coming to know so important researchers that are now meeting here in Argentina. I am glad and leave you with them. I want to introduce my friend Carlos Kotlik, who is professor at the National University of Cuyo in Mendoza, a city that lays beside the high Andes. Carlos has been treating myopic children at his local hospital with hypotensive drugs for more than 20 years, presenting his work in the American Academy of Ophthalmology. He will now speak about the ornithologist Josh Wallman, who passed by after 40 years of devoting himself kindly to myopia research and has been a mentor of many of us. Please, Carlos, go ahead. And thanks for being part of the organization of this symposium.
Hello, good morning, everybody. We're gonna begin our myopia symposium in Argentina 2020. My name is Carlos Kotlik from Mendoza, Argentina. And it's a pleasure for me to receive all these great researchers from all around the world here in our virtual country, I would say. So I'll begin with commemorating Josh Waldman. I've been working for 25 years already in treating myopia, and everything began with him. So emmetropization is a word we are all using very frequently now. It was first postulated by Straub in 1909. He said that the optical compounds were not associated by chance. They were correlated. He knew about this leptocortic distribution, that there were much more normal people that the Gaussian, the normal distribution should hope. So he knew something was happening, and it was not by chance that things happens. After that, Sorsby, Van Alplen, Duane, all these authors were working about this emmetropization, but they were all in statistical studies and not biological. Until this man came, this man changed everything, Josh Waldman. He worked in the Department of Biology of the City College in New York, and he began with these biological experiments. He knew about the local effect in the retina, even without the optic nerve. So here, everything began. He was fond of birds and myopia. He would say that his whole life were related to birds, all kinds of birds that he studied. He was a great guy studying and getting the idea of making experiments. And then he changed to myopia, and he finished his life working with myopia and changing all for us. This is one of his most common slides, where he knew about when the eggs of a chicken, they were just hatching, the dispersion of myopia and hypermetropia was high, and just living a little bit in 1 week, 2 weeks, 3 weeks, everything changed until in 8 weeks, we had almost all the chickens emmetropic. So he began studying the kerchief of a kind of doves, and he even defied Conrad Lorenz in showing that this kind of courtship of these birds, these doves, was, Conrad Lorenz thought it was genetic, and he defied him saying it was environmental, and he was right. Then he went to Harvard University, he made a PhD at Tufts University, and finally he ended up working at the biological department at the City College of New York for 39 years and made specially he was fond of all the kind of experiments you can imagine in myopia. So this is some things he did: eye movement, symmetropization, visual regulation of eye growth, a lot of studies, biochemistry, whatever you want, he made of. So one of the things he did interested me, and in the annual meeting in the year 2000 in Dallas, Texas, on October the 21st in the year 2000, I presented this work about slowing myopia progression in children, diminishing axial length, diminishing IOP, which I presented again in Buenos Aires in the year 2001 in July. And it was all began with Josh Waldman. Then I did the same kind of job. Instead of working with cardiolol, I worked with dorsolamine, and I presented this in Spanish always in the Congress of the Argentinian Congress of Ophthalmologists, CAO. And then in the year 2015, again, I worked with some other old papers that were saying that these hypotensors were not good for treating myopia. And I changed a little bit with the same numbers they have. I changed the way they studied it, and it was very significant. And then this year I was supposed to present in Amsterdam the super-diluted atropine at 0.01%, and I won't be able to do it because of the pandemic. Then in June this year, I presented this in this Argentinian magazine where I studied the whole thing I've been doing for 25 years, the cartilol group, the dorsolamide group, the studies I did from other papers, and the atropine 0.01%. So the original thing I think I did was just showing this ratio. Instead of talking about the eyeball growing, which is the second length minus the first length of the eyeball, what I did is I divided this difference, length, second length minus length at the beginning, divided the first length. So I made a ratio, because it's not the same growing from 18 millimeters to 20, that growing from 28 to 30. It's the same, always it's 2 millimeters, but in percentage it's all very different. The same I did with the progression, the myopia progression ratio. Instead of talking of diopters, I did refraction at the end minus the refraction at the beginning, divided by the first refraction, because it's not the same to change from -2 to -4, that changing from -8 to -10. And then with this kind of ratios, I studied this old works with timolol that said that were not significant, and they were significant. I studied them with this ANOVA test, because we have two variables, time and hypotensors, and I could not use the square she because if there were two variables, and it was significant. So now we know that we have to deal with outdoors, hypotensors, orthokeratology, bifocals or multifocals, filters. Even the American Academy of Ophthalmology says that there's some work with acupuncture working for it. The dark background that we're going to be talking just in a moment, and atropine today to treat myopia And as a resume of what I have done, in 1997, I began with Cartiolol, then Dorsalamid, then superdilute atropine that we're using now outdoors, this kind of bifocals and multifocals, the dark background that we're going to be talking next. And this is, I want you to begin, the researchers, the great people, the experts are going to begin now. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Carlos.
Professor José Rosema works in the Department of Ophthalmology of the University Hospital at Antwerp, Belgium. We became friends when we met at Arbo many years ago when he began with his project Gulstan, presenting his first poster. He holds two PhDs and works with Excel sheets as nobody else I know. He has been of great help in my studies of the lens with Bennett's equation. Discussing with him in our weekly exchange of information by mail, we discovered the oscillations in normal refractive development. Thank you, Hoss, for being so kind and participating in this symposium, speaking of what you found in more than 50 studies along the literature.
Hello, and thank you for your interest in our talk on the oscillations in the normal refractive development of young children. We have no special interest to declare on this topic. Our work starts from the question of what the normal course of refractive development is during the first years of life. Individual studies in the literature tend to give only a fragmented view on the topic, so we created an overview based on as many studies as we could find. Right after birth, the cyclopegic refraction in infants is on average about 2-2.5 diopters, while the refractive distribution tends to be rather broad, spanning from high hypermetropia until myopia. For preterm children, shown here in blue, the average refraction is emmetropic or even myopic, again with a broad distribution. In the following period, this distribution will narrow down very rapidly, while the average refraction becomes less hyperopic until it stabilizes. This is very pronounced in chickens on the left panel, but also visible in humans on the right panel. Looking at the longitudinal refraction by Mutti et al., a similar course is seen. Short after birth, the individual graphs are spread out and have an average of about 2-2.5 diopters. But this changes quickly to a much narrower distribution centered at 1 diopter by the age of 1.5 years. After that, the refraction appears to be stable. But if you look carefully, the hyperopia seems to be increasing again by about a quarter diopter between 1.5 and 4 years of age. Statistical analysis determined that this increase is indeed significant. So, is there really a mild hyperopization between the ages of 1 and 4 years, or is this a peculiarity of that specific data set? To find out, we collected all the population studies with cyclopegic refractive data that we could find, excluding only studies specifically investigating myopia. This gave us 65 studies with almost 70,000 measurements that altogether create a global picture of early refractive development. From the weighted average, shown as a solid red line, it is seen that before the birth, the refraction is myopic, but that it increases very rapidly to the birth refraction of about 2 diopters. After birth, a peak refraction is reached at 3 months, followed by a quick decline towards 1 diopter at 1.5 years. This is followed by the same increase that we saw in Mutti et al. Finally, there is a decrease again that is associated with an increased prevalence of myopia. But there is more. There are also 4 longitudinal studies for which we could obtain the raw data. For the 1997 dataset by Ehrlich et al., showing the refractive changes between 9 and 20 months of age, it is clearly seen that eyes with a refraction below plus 1 diopter tend to become more hyperopic, while those with a refraction just above plus 1 diopter become more myopic. Eyes with higher degrees of hyperopia mostly reduced their refraction as well, but some didn't change. Those are the hyperopic stragglers. Meanwhile, looking at the monthly refractive changes in all four longitudinal datasets combined, it is seen that, at first, the changes are predominantly hyperopic, but quickly become myopic, with a maximum at 6 months. Interestingly, there is a number of eyes that become more hyperopic at 10 months. Although these effects are larger, earlier, than the small hyperopic bump on the previous slides, it shows that refractive changes at this time are not necessarily myopic only. All of this seems to suggest that the second hyperopization phase between 1 and 4 years may be plausible. So where do these fluctuations come from? The answer lies in the way that the eye grows. During the first year, the eye grows 3 millimeters longer, which is as much as during the following 9 years combined. Optically, these actual changes are enormous and require major remodeling of the cornea and lens to keep the eye stable at low hyperopia. It is actually quite impressive how the eye is able to do this by adjusting the relative growth speed using a feedback system based on retinal blur. From the literature, we know that this is roughly how it works, but many details are still missing. The essence of this animation is shown again here as the changes in axial length and whole eye power, which is the combination of corneal and lens power. These two aspects must find some kind of balance during ametropization and the subsequent stable phase called homeostasis. You can see in the left panel that before birth, axial length grows at an exponential rate, but it slows down immediately after birth. Meanwhile, the whole eye power decreases very rapidly before birth, but here too there is a slowing down immediately after birth. Birth is, of course, the moment when light begins to enter the eye and the visual feedback systems can begin their work. Before that, eye growth was basically blind and based on the relative scales of the components. Given the extreme changes involved, you can consider this as two speeding bullets that need to hit each other from opposite sides. Without the feedback system, they are likely to miss, but with the feedback system, they are likely to slow down and oscillate around the common equilibrium until stability is reached. In the final step, we compare the whole eye power with the axial power, which is the optical power required to place a sharp image on the retina of a specific axial length. The difference between these two parameters corresponds with the spherical refraction. As you can see, the fluctuations of the ocular and axial power are relatively minor compared to their size, but still they lead to an oscillating behavior in refraction that is seen in the combined literature data shown before. To conclude, we would like to say that early refractive development exhibits a oscillating behavior due to the interaction between ocular and axial powers. The frequency and amplitude vary between individuals, much like any other parameter of the human body, and these processes contribute to a tightening of the refractive distribution. We thank you for your attention and we look forward to any comments you may have.
The next speaker is Professor Pei Chang Wu, who works in the Kaohsiung Changgung Memorial Hospital in Changgung University of Taiwan. And he is the principal investigator of Taiwan School Children Visual Care Program in the Ministry of Education. Under his counseling, the epidemics of myopia in Taiwan has been reversed. This is why we have asked him to come and tell us of his experience. Dear Pei Chang Wu, thank you for your contribution. And I know you are a very active surgeon and have been in charge of the Retina Society of Taiwan. Thank you for being here. Please, go ahead.
I'm Pei Chang Wu from Taiwan. Thanks to the organizer committee to invite me to share interventions for myopia prevention in schools. As we know, Unaided vision acuity is widely used to detect the myopia in school children. It has the highest sensitivity and specificity. In Taiwan from 1980s, school nurses perform unaided visual acuity screening every semester. If school children with vision decreased to 20 over 25, they will be referred to ophthalmologist for further treatment. There is a Taiwan nationwide myopia survey with a psychometric reflection in 2006. We can see the myopia prevalence has very high correlation with the prevalence of reduced visual acuity from grade 1 to grade 6 school children. From 1980s, Taiwan's government instructed several departments to initiate the vision care program, including the Department of the Health and the Ministry of Education. In 1999, for the myopia prevention, the MOE launched an enhanced school children vision care 5-year program. In this program, for myopia prevention, school children were encouraged to gaze into the distance and the eye exercise during the races, and also to encourage to have the habit of near work breaks. In the classroom, the room light will also adjust up to 500 lux, and the table height will adjust according to the children's body height. However, the prevalence of the reduced vision activity is a proxy of myopia prevalence is increasing and increased every year up to around 50% in 2009. So many school teachers and the nurse were very discouraged. Fortunately, in 2008, Professor Ross and Morgan published a paper suggests that outdoor activity could reduce the prevalence of myopia in school children. According to this paper and our domestic study, we suggest the government that implemented the outdoor activity into the school children care vision care program might have some help for the increased myopia prevalence. Thereafter, in 2010, Ministry of Education launched a new school children vision care program till now. This program encourages children to have outdoor activity up to 120 minutes per day to increase the outdoor time. The prevalence of the reduced visual acuity dramatically decreased at the first time after 1 year promoted the outdoor activity and continues to decrease 1% every year in 1 million school children. For the senior group and the junior group, outdoor activity both has the effect on the decreased the prevalence of reduced visual acuity. The effect is more prominent in junior group. We also have another study. It is a school-based cluster randomized trial named the ROCT 711 study. The results showed that outdoor activity not only retard the myopia shift, but also inhibit the myopia progression in non-myopic children and the myopic school children. In addition, moderate outdoor light intensity with longer time exposure could have effect on the myopia prevention instead of the strong sunlight exposure. In conclusion, outdoor activity 2 hours per day for myopia intervention is according to a evidence-based medicine. It is a protective factor and simple, free, and effective. Children could encourage to go outdoors during the races. It has the additional effect, such as in breath in new work. Moderate sunlight exposure is enough. Outdoor activity not only prevented the myopia onset, but also partly retarded myopia progression in myopic children. It could be promoted with reduction of obesity, enhance the social activity, increase the vitamin D supplement under the sunlight. Outdoor activity could be used in clinical practice and also policy intervention in school for myopia prevention. Further study for the light duration, frequency, and wavelength is warranted. Thank you for your attention.
Professor Yuval Cohen is lecturing at Bar-Ilan University in Israel as he is an active surgeon and pediatric ophthalmologist at Ziv Medical Center, Safed, Israel. As a young investigator, he worked with Richard Stone in Philadelphia with low ambient light myopia in chickens raised under only 50 lux. When he returned to Israel several years ago, he began to study illuminance in kindergarten children, and he has discovered that indoor illuminance can affect refractive error even before myopia onset. Dear Yuval, thank you for your important contribution in this symposium that gathers people from all over the world.
Thank you very much for the invitation for the myopia symposium. I would like to talk about the ambient light in nursery school and children's refraction, a study that was conducted in Israel. And we have no financial interest in the study. So myopia is known to be associated with genetic and environmental risk factors. And there is a great rise in the prevalence of myopia in the last decades that might be attributed for a common environmental risk factor that a clue from studies performed 30 years ago might attribute.
Professor Yuval Cohen is lecturing at Bar-Ilan University. Professor Yuval Cohen is lecturing at Bar-Ilan University in Israel as he is an active surgeon and pediatric ophthalmologist at Zip Medical Center, Safed, Israel. As a young investigator, he worked with Richard Stone in Philadelphia with low ambient light myopia in chickens raised under only 50 lux. When he returned to Israel several years ago, he began to study illuminance in kindergarten children, and he has discovered that indoor illuminance can affect refractive error even before myopia onset. Dear Shubal, thank you for your important contribution in this symposium that gathers people from all over the world.
Thank you very much for the invitation for the myopia symposium. I would like to talk about the ambient light in nursery school and children's refraction, a study that was conducted in Israel. We have no financial interest in the study. So myopia is known to be associated with genetic and environmental risk factors. And there is a great rise in the prevalence of myopia in the last decades that might be attributed for a common environmental risk factor that a clue from studies performed 30 years ago might attribute this change to maybe the outdoor activity and the time outdoor. And it was shown that with the increased amount of time that children spend outdoors, there is a reduction in the onset of myopia. So what is the hypothesis behind the outdoor activity and myopia? It might be related to accommodation under the focus mechanism or the image blur as a dependent of pupil size. And last, it might be related to light intensity that present the light outdoor is, the intensity is very high, and that might contribute through a normal hormonal control to a alteration in refraction. That was shown in a study conducted about 15 years ago in animal studies. And you can see here, the higher the intensity, the higher or the hyperopic the refraction. The high intensity group means in an intensity of about 10,000 lux that imitates outdoor light levels. However, also the medium and low intensity group have different refractive development. Medium intensity means that the intensity was about 500 lux. That is the intensity of a regular room. And we didn't really expect that animal that lives in such light, which seems to be strong, will develop myopia, but some of them did. And you can see that under low intensity of 50 lux, all the chicks develop myopia. In another study, we showed that the retinal activity was different between the groups concerning the dopamine and the DOPA concentration. And there is a doubling of the concentration between the low and the medium intensity group. So much is going on in the low level of light intensity. In this study, we addressed this issue in children. And the aim of the study was to measure the effect of nursery school light intensity on refraction and pupil diameter. We included over 1,000 children. It was a very large study from 39 nursery schools that attend the same nursery school for at least 6 months. The children were inside the nursery school most of the day, from 7:30 nearly to 3 o'clock, and were outside for a very short period of time at 11 a.m. for only 30 minutes. We measured the light intensity at the corners and at the center, and the outdoor light intensity in the sun and in the shade. The two parameters that we are going to present here are the non-cycloplegic refraction and pupil diameter that was measured using the PlusOptics photo screener. And we excluded over 100 children that had either incomplete data or the data was odd, over minus three diopters for a very small number of children, and children that suffers from strabismus. So the results. Overall, we included 1,071 children. Most of them were hyperopic. We artificially divide, for statistical reasons, the groups into low, medium, and high intensity. And the low intensity group nursery score was 340 lux, the medium intensity 460 lux, and the high intensity was 600 lux. The intensity was significantly different between the nursery schools. Outside, outdoor, the intensity was the same. It was over 80,000 lux. The mean age of the children did not vary between the groups. And the results. The nursery school indoor light intensity were found to be positively correlated with spherical refraction, and the correlation was 0.19. The pupil size and spherical refraction were positively correlated. It was 0.1, so it was weak. The light indoor was not correlated with the cylinder. We can see here the spherical equivalent of the groups. The spherical equivalent was less than 0.6 for the low intensity, over 0.7 for the medium intensity, and over 0.8 diopters for the high intensity group. And the ANOVA test was significant. The pupil diameter was nearly the same for all the groups. It was a slightly larger for the high intensity group. We didn't expect that result, but that might suggest that they had a blurred image under high intensity. In this case, high intensity considering 600 lux. Thus, we conclude that in the nursery school, the higher the indoor light intensity, the greater the refraction. Thus, we have to monitor the nursery school light intensity as part of the child safety. Light-dependent pupil diameter is less likely to be involved in refractive development. Thank you very much, and thank you for your attention.
My friend Professor Ian Morgan is working in the Australian National University and the Songstan Ophthalmic Center, Sun Yat-sen University, both in Australia and in Guangzhou. When Bill Stell introduced us by email in 2004, Ian shared the information he had about a seminal paper and a review called How Genetic is School Myopia. in which he explained that myopia epidemics was environmental even before his group discovered that outdoor exposure and reading habits were the main risk factors for myopia development. In the last 15 years since that discovery, we have exchanged a lot of information and written many things together, and he's so friendly that I think of him as if he were one of my family members. Thank you, Ian, for being here in this symposium.
Thanks for that introduction. I do have to declare that I have a consultancy with Essilor on methods of myopia control. In 2015, the journal Nature published this stunning picture, which encapsulates in one image the high prevalence of myopia that has emerged in some parts of the world. And Nature called it the myopia boom. This brought to an end a period in which myopia had been regarded as under tight genetic control and inaugurated the era in which myopia is recognized as strongly influenced by environmental factors. The real numbers are here. In all across East Asia and in Singapore in Southeast Asia, the prevalence of myopia in children completing their education, their school education, is about 80%, and 10 to 20% of them are highly myopic and, of course, exposed to the long-term risks of pathological myopia. Now, this situation emerged very rapidly in this region after the Second World War, when these countries started to develop economically and where their economic development was based on development of a highly educated population. You can see that for most of the region, the prevalence of myopia increased up to this level over a period of about 40 to 50 years. In contrast, in the People's Republic of China, mainland China, this process was delayed until the end of the Cultural Revolution by about 20 years. And this shows how important social and political decisions about education are for the development of a myopia epidemic. Now, it's not just in this part of the world that we see this phenomenon. There's one other group that shows the same epidemic of myopia, and that's Jewish boys educated in religious schools in Israel and probably all over the world. The numbers are here. In Israel, the prevalence of myopia increases systematically as you go from secular schools to orthodox schools to ultra-orthodox schools. Equally, the prevalence of high myopia goes up. And in ultra-orthodox schools, at the end of schooling, boys are about 80% myopic and around 25% highly myopic. It's important to note that their sisters don't show these characteristics. They're more like children educated in secular schools. Now, we obviously can't explain this by a genetic resemblance between Jewish boys in ultra-Orthodox schools and East Asians. But what they share is the early onset of intensive education, starting at the age of 4 or 5 with heavy study load. What this and a whole lot of other data that I can't show you establishes that the prevalence of myopia in a population is related to childhood exposures rather than population genetics. We've been able to identify two major risk factors. The first one, which promotes myopia, are educational pressures, long hours of intense study that start particularly early, so that children in East Asia are getting homework, written homework, at the age of 4 or 5. This promotes myopia, but there's another factor, and that's time outdoors in brighter light, that prevents the development of myopia. The important thing is that both are modifiable, so we can act to turn this situation around. Now, there are many lines of evidence for education as a causal risk factor. I won't take you through them all, but it's important to note that if there was any doubt about the causal direction, Mendelian randomization has shown that more years of education cause more myopia rather than the other way around. You can see the link between myopia and education in this graph, where children don't go to school or have very little formal education, the prevalence of myopia is very low, 1-2%, and this is probably predominantly genetic. As the intensity of education increases, more children go further with schooling, you reach the situation typical of modern Western education, where at the end of schooling, about 20% of children have become myopic and only 1-2% highly myopic. And then you get this jump to modern East education, where East Asian education, where roughly 80% of children become myopic at the end of schooling with the high prevalence of high myopia I've already mentioned. How can we explain this difference? Well, it comes from two factors. Firstly, East Asian education is much more intensive than typical Western education. School days are long, there's a lot of emphasis on rote learning, but perhaps the most important factor is the early onset of education, where children of the age of 4 or 5 are receiving written homework. There are a lot of other factors that contribute. A competitive environment set up by key schools and private tutoring schools. Countering these trends are the amount of time that children spend outdoors. We first provided evidence for a protective effect of time outdoors in a paper in 2008. You can see that the children most at risk are those who combine a lot of near work and little time outdoors. But if those children maintain their level of near work but spend more time outdoors, then they are protected from the development of myopia. So we have a protective effect of time outdoors. We think we understand the mechanism. Bright light outdoors stimulates dopamine release, which inhibits axial elongation. And this protective effect has been confirmed in several trials in China and Taiwan. 80 minutes per day roughly halves the rate of onset of myopia. And this has been now implemented at a national level in Taiwan and to some extent in Singapore, and hopefully over the next couple of years in the People's Republic of China. Now I want to turn to the future, because there are a set of predictions which suggests that by the year 2050, the whole world will resemble East Asia, apart from Oceania and Africa. Around 50% of the world's population will be myopic, and about 10% will be highly myopic, according to these predictions. But I want you to look closely at the data from your own part of the world, Latin America. The prediction is that by 2050, Latin America will be in the same grip of an epidemic as is seen in East Asia. You've already seen the data presented by Rafael Iribarren, which shows that the prevalence of myopia is actually very low in Latin America. And it seems almost impossible that Latin America will reach the stage suggested by these predictions within the next 30 years. If this situation is going to develop, then Latin America will have to adopt the same intensive educational practices and the same limitations on time outdoors for children that you see in East Asia. And I think that is very unlikely to happen. So in conclusion, we can turn back the epidemic of myopia with more time outdoors to reduce overall myopia and clinical interventions to slow the progression of myopia to high myopia and then to pathological myopia. East Asia and Southeast Asia need both of these immediately. The rest of the world doesn't can concentrate for the moment on clinical interventions to slow the progression of myopia to high myopia. In the rest of the world, what we need to do is to monitor the prevalence of myopia or even just low uncorrected visual acuity in representative samples of senior high school students and the percentage of the age cohort who complete school. This will enable us to see if an epidemic is emerging. The vision community needs to pay attention to what is happening in schools and in the lifestyles of children so that we can anticipate the emergence of an epidemic of myopia and take action to prevent it.
Frank Scheffel works in Tübingen, Germany, in the section of neurobiology of the eye, Institute of Ophthalmic Research, Center of Ophthalmology of the University of Tübingen. When I met him for the first time, he was at ARVO showing his power refractor and his experiments in chicks. I already knew that he was the man who developed a chick model of emmetropization and myopia, putting negative and positive lenses to growing chicken eyes in 1988. Since that young times, he has devoted his life to study ocular growth in his lab and has produced many important papers. Now, he is in the way of unraveling why reading has produced myopia since old times. Thank you, Frank, for being here.
Okay, welcome everybody. I'm talking about the question in how far reading might cause myopia. And as you can see here in the middle of the page, this is a quite general question because it's very well known that myopia is correlated with the years of education. And there's still a lot of doubts whether it's only reading which makes you myopic during education. And in fact, on my next slide, I'm showing a few recently or not so recently published papers showing the link between reading and myopia. And I must say the evidence for that reading makes you myopic is not as clear as the evidence for years of education and myopia. Nevertheless, seen paper was by Sangmai Saw in 2002, who published in IOVS that children who read more than two books a week are having longer axial length. And the second paper that showed this was appearing in 2008, again showing that continuous reading might be a possible risk factor for myopia. There is also a very well-noted paper by Silberman et al. In 1993 showing that Jewish school children depend differently much myopia depending on whether they were in an Orthodox school or in a general school. And you can see only the boys apparently were in this Orthodox school, and they have a very short reading distance which is slightly varied during their studies, and they study many hours per day, and they actually show a much higher rate of myopia than the children in general schools. Below, I show you another study that came from Finland, and this study was by Persin and Lyra, appeared in 2000, 1993, and there you can see that the reading distance in the bottom, reading distance correlates with myopic progression and also the time spent during reading. And this is shown in the upper graph here. The significance is not extremely high, but it's clearly significant. And this is one of the studies that shows a clear correlation between reading and myopia. And finally, in 2005, a very well observed publication appeared by Kathy Rose and Ian Morgan. This is basically a preview in The New Scientist, saying that lifestyle causes myopia, and he states, or they state in their paper, that there's plenty of evidence that reading causes myopia. It's already said in the abstract, but these are basically the evidences that are around. Now, why might reading make you myopic? And this is a very long history in this question, because until about 1970 or so, people considered intraocular pressure as a major reason for myopia to develop. And the assumption was that during convergence and accommodation, intraocular pressure goes up, which basically expands the globe. And this was the conclusion here, a paper by Green in 1980. However, as you all know, in about exactly 1987, Josh Wallman came with a completely new description of the regulation of eye growth, and he showed that you can first induce myopia in local retinal areas. This was published in Science in 1987. But David Troilo in his lab also showed, together with Michael Gottlieb, that if you cut the optic nerve, you basically disconnect the eye from the brain, but you still get a strong response in eye growth with both lenses or diffusers, telling you that accommodation can't be it, because certainly without optic nerve, you will not get any accommodation, because there is no command coming back from the brain. That local eye growth can occur was later shown by the lab of Earl Smith. They also used hemifield lenses, as we used in chickens before, and could show that you can make only half of the eye more myopic, and the other that was exposed to normal vision didn't become myopic. Well, it's not only deprivation, as you know. You can really find out that the retina responds also to the plane of defocus. If you put it in front, the eye grows less. If you put it behind, it grows more. And this was shown in a number of animal models. At the end, it's very clear that ametropization is based on a closed loop feedback system that controls the eye growth such that the focal plane matches the retina best. Now, how could this be taken to explain the link between reading and myopia? And this was really not all that easy, but a really new idea came out by Jane Gwersta and her group. In 1993, they found that children who were myopic showed a larger lack of accommodation. They didn't focus as precisely as emmetropic children, although this data shows still a considerable lack also in normal children. So it's certainly always a matter of which device you take to measure this, but that we have a lack of accommodation for increasingly short viewing distance is well known, and it would be a very plausible idea that placing the focal plane behind the retina could really tell the retina that the eye should grow more. And the hypothesis was nice, but the literature over the years didn't really manage to show that the lack of accommodation predicts myopia. In particular, Don Mutti and his colleagues showed there's no predictive value in early lacks of accommodation before children are myopic. So it's not clear whether the lack really has a functional role in the development of myopia. And we have recent studies on the chicken model. This was a student in the lab, Andrea Allmann. She studied in very much detail how big the accommodation errors were in chickens who were wearing negative lenses. So it was measured how precisely would they compensate for the lens. And it turned out they didn't care too much. They may be in focus for a short moment, but otherwise they keep their accommodation pretty lagging behind. And now the question is, a chick that has a lot of lack of accommodation, would it become more quickly myopic or not? Because this was the prediction, basically, But in fact, as you can see, many chickens measured, many lacs of accommodation measured here, but none of these chicks showed really a prediction that a larger lac caused more myopia. And this is shown here in this graph. All this was measured with a Lenstar in vivo. You get extremely precise vitreous chamber depth measurements. Now, since accommodation is really not clear, what is the role of accommodation in myopia and reading and myopia? It's not clear. And you can also see this from the number of publications in the area. Huge amount of publications and still no final answer. So could it be that there are some special retinal stimulations that drive myopia during reading rather than accommodation? And I would like now to go to the major point of this talk, which is assume that the retina doesn't like text that is read on white paper. And it could be that this is something that the retina takes to drive eye growth. And this is a study that we have undertaken. First, I would like make a few remarks about on and off channels in the retina. You know, in our eye, we have about 125 million photoreceptors here. And these photoreceptors are need to be compressed to about 1 million cables that go through the optic nerve. And the tricks that the retina uses for this are basically two. One is pooling receptors in the periphery, largely of the visual field. But second, also not to read out each single pixel as a camera does, but rather take only differences. And this gives rise to the so-called on-off system in the retina, which is continued through the brain, which means you have ganglion cells that prefer bright light in the middle of their receptive fields and dark around it. Then they start firing very heavily. But you also have ganglion cells that are the opposite way, and these are the off cells. Then this is on cells, this is off cell. And what happens now, if you have a homogeneously illuminated area, these cells will not say anything because the background and the surrounding, the center and the surrounding are equally bright. So this has a big advantage that you don't waste firing in the ganglion cells if there is nothing, no object in the area, if there is homogeneous illumination. And in fact, you can see that our retina doesn't transmit very nicely absolute brightnesses to the brain because this Adelson illusion, which I show here, shows you that even though every person would assume that this is a brighter field than this one, in fact, the brightness of these two fields is exactly the same as you can see here. And all this tells you that absolute luminances are not really transmitted to the brain. It's all a comparison only. Now, if you selectively block on or off channels, this was first done by Earl Smith again in 1989, so a while ago. He used a drug in cats to actually exclude the off channel. And he used this, excluded the on or the off channel with APB. I only just managed to off-channel activity by itself is not sufficient to drive normal eye growth. So he excluded the on-channel in these cats. And you can see that there are huge changes in axial eye growth. These are individual animals. And you can see all animals who only had the off-channels, they all got considerably shorter than the eyes that had on-channels included. And this was basically the first demonstration that on and off-channels have an important role in eye growth. Later, Sheila and David Kruther, they developed an experiment where they could either stimulate preferentially the on channel or the off channel. And they did this by having the chickens in an arena where they were exposed to a ramp-shaped temporal profile of luminance. And they found, depending on whether you stimulate on and off channel, preferentially, you could either inhibit or enhance myopia development that was induced by lenses. They also did this in a pharmacological study, worked equally well. And I also show a few more studies in the area showing here that if you block on or off channels by genetic tricks, you can show that if you have no functional on channel, then you can enhance deprivation myopia. And if you have no functional off channel, then you get less deprivation myopia or none at all. Now, our question was, how is the distribution of on and off in the visual environment of normal visual environments, like a group of people or outside in the forest or anywhere? And therefore, I developed some software that quantified on and off channel activity. And this was a quite simple procedure. I took a pixel, then I read out the brightness, then I take the surrounding pixels, read their brightness. And if the center pixel is brighter than the peripheral pixels, then I tell this area of the image is an on-stimulating area. This was done in 260,000 or so pixels, and all was summed up, and then I can tell there's a lot of on activity or off activity. And it was found out that pictures, normal pictures, largely provide balanced on-off input ratio. Accidentally, I directed my camera then to a text that was pasted to the wall, and I found that in a normal text like this one here, black text on white, you get a lot of overstimulation of the off channels. And you can see here the off-channel activity is plotted in red. In normal text, there is a lot of activity in the red. But if you invert the text, you get a lot of activity in the on channel. So you can quantify on and off activity over the spatial frequency range and find out that text with inversion has more on activity as opposed to text that is black and white as normal has more off activity. Now, how can we show that this has something to do with myopia? So what we did, we let people read from a screen at 3 meter distance, and there was text either of this kind, which means dark text on bright background, or bright text on dark background. And note that the brightness on average is the same in both. So it's really only the matter of the contrast, not the absolute luminances. And after 30 minutes and 1 hour, it was found that in all seven young subjects, the choroid became thinner when you overstimulate the off channel by reading normal text, and it became thicker when you read the text inverted. You can see this here on causes thicker choroid. This is choroidal thickness. This was carefully analyzed, and at the end, yeah, you can say you get already after 30 minutes a significant difference in choroidal thickness with reading of text with inverted contrast. Now, sorry for the sound. These are the chickens here in this cage. We also developed artificial stimuli that stimulate either on or off channels. And these are little fields here on the screen, which either increase rapidly in brightness and fall down slowly, or the other way around. So it's an on and off stimulus. And if you treat the chickens in such an environment, as you can see here, they don't care very much. Then you get nicely the changes in choroidal thickness, even though they don't read. We don't have to read them, the chickens can't read. And this is a human study using all these artificial stimulus, and we again can see that choroidal thickness can also change with this artificial stimuli. Now, what we also tested is dopamine. You all know that dopamine is a good kind of link to myopia development. Low dopamine increases the risk of getting myopic. And interestingly, with our artificial stimuli, we also found that more dopamine was released from the retina in the artificial on stimulation and less in the off stimulation, despite that the brightness was always kept the same. And basically, it tells you that you can change dopamine quite nicely without changing luminances. I don't want to touch the point down here. We did also lens experiments with this contribution of on and off, and the data are actually published in Investigative Ophthalmology in 2019. Now, let's go a little bit further. We could now go on and make movies of this kind. These movies are either stimulating the on or off channels in preference. And this is tested here below. So this is an on-stimulating movie where all these bright edges stimulate the on cells. And this is an off-stimulating movie. And we found that even in this case, you can get differences in choroidal thickness just by changing the on and off contribution in these movies. And this gives possibly a new opportunity to inhibit myopia by filtering your visual exposure so that more on is stimulated. And I would like to conclude here with this statements. So reading text with inverted contrast polarities generates bidirectional changes in choroidal thickness, which can perhaps be used to inhibit myopia. We still don't have a children's study. It would be great to have one where children read from a computer screen with inverted text, and hopefully one will start in the future. Then artificial visual stimuli can be developed to thicken the choroid and increase dopamine release without changing luminance. And this leads to the conclusion that movies and perhaps computer games games could be changed so that they stimulate more on and perhaps therefore inhibit myopia. I would like also to make clear that there are always pitfalls, so the baseline luminance needs to be determined in detail. We don't know whether this all works in bright, very bright conditions or low light conditions. This is, has to be studied. And this is a very general question. Do short-term changes in choroidal thickness really have predictive power for future myopia development? I think most people believe they do, but it's hard to prove at this point. There are largely studies by Scott Reed in children who show, which show that if the choroid thickens, these children have less risk to get myopic, but still there's work in this area necessary. Thank you very much for listening.
Professor Virginie Beruba, after completing her medical and genetic epidemiological studies, she completed a PhD at the Erasmus University Medical Center at Rotterdam in the Netherlands, studying the Generation R cohort. And she wrote her doctoral thesis about what causes myopia, as she called it, finding the link between multiple genetic factors and the few environmental risk factors for this disease. So we are very pleased to have met her and that she accepted the invitation to this symposium that gathers important researchers from all over the world.
Hello everyone. My name is Virginie Verhoeven. I'm a clinical geneticist and postdoctoral researcher working on ophthalmogenetic diseases and mainly myopia in the Erasmus Medical Center in Rotterdam. And I first would like to thank Raphael for organizing this great symposium and for the invitation to speak to you today. And I have been asked to talk about the genetic risk factors for non-pathological school myopia. Myopia is caused by a complex interplay between genetic factors and environmental factors. When we're talking about school myopia, we're talking about many, many hundreds of genetic variants that integrate with environmental factors such as near work and outdoor exposure, and in the end cause school myopia. So heritability estimates for refractive error are somewhere between 60% and 80%. So the genetic component of myopia and refractive error is well recognized, but its magnitude varies in studies depending on the population being studied, the study design, and the methodology. So if we want to identify genetic factors for a complex genetic trait, such as myopia, involving many genes and environmental factors, we usually go for an approach called genome-wide association studies, because otherwise we would it would require eye tissue-specific research or animal studies, which is not ideal. So with a genome-wide association study, we would use single nucleotide polymorphism, genetic variants that are very common among population, and we would look at millions of SNPs, as we call them, and look at the association of a particular SNP and refractive error or myopia in various populations, and in the end metallize these associations. So if we take a look at a timeline of the history of gene finding in refractive error myopia, you can clearly see that from the beginning there were a few MIP loci that were found through linkage studies, but it wasn't until the introduction of genome-wide association studies that we were able to find genes associated with myopia. And to date, and there are more than 500 genetic loci or genetic factors identified for school myopia. And as mentioned, in genome-wide association studies, we look at millions of genetic variants per individual, and this requires large, big data sets to be able to pick up any associations. So back in 2010, our group was the first to identify one genetic factor, the GJD2 gene, for refractive error, together with a study from the Twins UK identifying the RAS-GRF gene, both on chromosome 15, by using data from 4,000 or 5,000 people. But now we're already working with data sets of 500,000 people being able to pick up more than 500 genetic factors for myopia. And as you can imagine, this requires collaborations and working within consortiums. So most importantly, the CREAM consortium and Biobank have been working on this, as well as a commercial company, 23andMe. So what have we learned from all these big data sets? Well, to look at the bigger picture, by performing pathway analyses, we have been able to see the most important pathways for school myopia, which are depicted here. So most importantly, these were the retinal outer nuclear layer and detection of light stimulus from the CREAM paper from 2018, and from the UK Biobank paper from 2020, there were two additional important pathways, such as circadian rhythm and pigmentation. And what we also did was look at the expression of the various genetic factors identified. And what was remarkable that all retinal cell times seem to contribute to the retinal to sclera signaling cascade that initiates the growth of the eye in school myopia. And also there is quite some overlap between the common refractive error genes that we have been able to identify with genome-wide association studies and syndromic myopia genes. So if we look at the individual genetic variants that are identified through GWAS studies, it is clear to see that these variants are very frequent among the population and their effect sizes are fairly low. So the individual effect of a single gene is not the way to look at this. So what we usually tend to do is combining all the genetic factors and their risks into a polygenic risk score, giving a better idea on what the risk of a particular person is. So for instance, in this graph on the left-hand side, you can see the people with a low genetic risk who are far less at risk to get myopic than the people on the right hand side with a high genetic risk to become myopic. So a question that is frequently asked to me is, are we going to use genetic profiling for myopia patients in clinic? Well, I don't think so, because there is a very easy way to measure the risk of myopia, which is by measuring the actual length and plot it in the growth curves that you can see here. So the genetic studies that we have been performing are mainly to find the genetic background and unraveling the most important pathways for myopia. So with the current genetic studies, we are still only able to explain approximately 20% of the genetic variants of myopia and refractive error. So what is next? Of course, environmental factors play an important role, and gene environmental interaction studies can give more insight into this missing heritability. We are working on more in-depth genotyping, so using exome chip and exome sequencing and whole genome sequencing in our patients to identify more genetic variants. We're performing experimental studies on the identified genes. And combined omics is also something that should be on our agenda for the coming years. So in conclusion, genetic studies for school myopia have identified more than 500 genetic variants, explaining approximately 20% of the variants of refractive error. The functions of these genes is extremely diverse, but what is remarkable that all retinal cell types seem to be involved. I don't think genetic testing is going to be a clinical application, and most important, we use it to elucidate the molecular mechanism underlying myopia. And with this, I would like to end my presentation by thanking the Myopia Research Group at Erasmus Medical Center, in particular the persons mentioned here, our collaborators, so the CREAM Consortium, UK Biobank and 23andMe, and our funding. Thanks again. Bye-bye.
Professor Jason Jam is Associate Professor at the Department of Ophthalmology and Visual Science of the Chinese University of Hong Kong. He's Head of the Pediatric Ophthalmology and Strabismus Services at the Hong Kong Eye Hospital and head of the ophthalmology department at Hong Kong Children's Hospital. He's in charge of one of the most important human studies of atropine at different concentrations in Hong Kong primary school children, those children who are prone of developing high myopia in this particular environment. He will speak about the recent findings of that important study of different atropine concentrations. Thank you, Jason, for being so kind in participating in this symposium.
Hello, everybody. It's my great honor and pleasure to share a topic here today on atropine to slow myopia progression, the current status. I'm Jason Yam from Hong Kong. I have no financial interest to disclose. I would like to thank all the teamwork from my department and my team, especially all my colleagues. Over the past few years, we are working on the Hong Kong Children Eye Study, and also today I'm going to share the LAM study, and also the Hong Kong High Myopia Cohort and Hong Kong Children Eye Biobank. How to retard myopia progression? We know there is three main methods: the outdoor activity intervention, optical intervention, and pharmacological intervention. And today we talk about the atropine eye drops for myopia control. A lot of the wonderful work has been done by our colleagues from Taiwan, which use a lot of atropine, varies from 1% concentration to low concentration. But the popularity of the low concentration atropine has to be credited to our colleague from Singapore, the APTOM 2 study, which looked into 0.5%, 0.1%, and 0.01% atropine dating back to 2012. And over the 5 years, the APTOM 2 study, number one, during the third year, they found the myopia rebound of the 0.01 is very minimal. And over 5 years, 0.01% atropine seems to work better comparing to originally used 0.5% and 0.1% atropine. However, one important limitation is the lack of a placebo control group. This picture showing the 5 years APTOM 2 study, which shows that 0.01% atropine work better than the other groups over 5 years of time. In a meta-analysis, also suggests that within a certain dose, the efficacy of atropine is dose independent, whereas the adverse effects are dose dependent. That means attract people to use much, much, much lower concentration if it is effective. However, there's still unknown and unanswered, number one, because before our project, there's lacking placebo control group for comparison, whether there's any concentration dependent response and what is the optimal concentration. So we started our study, LAM study, to determine the optimal concentration eye drops, atropine eye drops in reducing the myopia progression. It is a double-blind, placebo-controlled, randomized control trial in 0.5%, 0.025%, 0.01%, and placebo in 1:1:1:1 ratio. We have recruited 438 subjects, children, from 4 to 12 years of age. And this is the result. Over the first year, we found that, in fact, there is a concentration, there's a quite a clear concentration-dependent response. From 0.05%, 0.025%, 0.01%, and placebo group. You can see this is the spherical equivalent changes, and this is the SCLN changes. There is a mirror image showing that the SC and the spherical equivalent and the SU link is very corresponding to the concentration dependent response. In particular, the 0.01% and the placebo group in the change in the SU link, there is not statistically significant. Conversion to the effectiveness, 0.05% confer about 67% reduction in the myopia progression compared to the placebo group, where 0.01% confer about 27% in reduction. And the accommodation change, pupil's diameter and visual acuity are the side effect we are very concerned, but the accommodation size, accommodation change in the 0.05% is about 2 diopter loss, whereas 0.01% is about minimal compared to the placebo group. However, two diopter loss in the accommodation in the 0.05% are considered clinically not significant. And the visual acuity are all normal, whereas the need of the photochromatic glasses comparing the all the group are similar. So there's no significant differences in the clinical side effect at 1 year. Visual quality questionnaire is also similar across all the group. So we are the first placebo controlled trial on RCT on the low concentration atropine with a large sample size, low dropout rate, and a comprehensive investigation. We shows that there is a concentration dependent response and all the group are well tolerated, and 0.05% HOP seems to be most effective in the first year of age, first follow up. In fact, a very recent study, also from our speaker, Professor Li Shimin group, also used 0.01% compared to placebo group, shows approximately 34% reduction rate. So it is very similar to our results. However, the question go on. In the ABTOM 2 study, during the second year, in fact, the efficacy is much better during the second year in the 0.01%. That means the clinical efficacy of low concentration atropine in the second year is much better than the first year, resulting clinically not significant between all the concentration. So we are asking the second question, whether the concentration dependent response will be remained over all these concentration during the second year. So we follow up our study. However, the placebo group has to be switched over to the 0.05% in our study due to the ethical concern. And because we have already proven the concentration is effective, the result is like that. Here, we shows that 0.05%, 0.025%, 0.01%, and the switch over group are all, you can still remain the concentration dependent response in the SE and in the SU length. Here, I want to show our notable discussion. There are several points. Number one, 0.05% remain the most efficacious concentration over 2 years. And the 0.05% atropine double the concentration of double the effect of 0.01% over 2 years. And the efficacy of the second year was clinically similar to the first year in the LAMP study. That is not in the ATOM 2 study. And in the switch over group, 0.05% is very effective compared to the self-control, and all three concentrations remain well tolerated. Another question we want to move on to ask is, there's an observed discrepancy between the effect of the SE progression and the SE elongation. Some people postulate whether there's a change in the corneal curvature and the corneal power. The clear question is whether anti-myopic effect of the low concentration atropine is mediated via the SE elongation or associated biometric changes. So our third report to answer this question is, we look into the change in the parameter in the SU length, the corneal curvature, the lens power, anterior chamber depth, and the corneal astigmatism. Here is the main result. It shows that here is the SU length, but the corneal power, lens power, anterior chamber depth is not significant. Well, as the SU elongation is significant among all the group, but the change in the corneal power and lens power are similar among the group. So that our study confirmed that low concentration atropine has no effect on the corneal power and lens power. The contribution to the SU progression from SU length corneal power in each atropine group and placebo group were similar. Therefore, the anti-myopia effect is mainly on retarding the SU elongation and thus can reduce the myopia complication. So in the third year, the perspective, we are randomized each of the three groups, 0.05%, 0.025%, 0.01% into washout group and continued treatment group. And our data are ready, and we are going to the process of preparation and submission. I hope that we can share the result very soon with you all. So I'd like to thank my team and especially my mentor, Professor Kelvin Peng here and Professor Clement Tan here, and also Professor Chen Lei Gai, my colleague Dr. Gum, and also Mandy Ng, our nurse manager, for all the work we work together for the healthcare through children eye care. Thank you very much for all your attention and your time. Thank you.
Thank you, Jason Zhang. Very nice presentation.
About 20 years ago, a friend in common presented us by email. Professor Bill Stell, as he calls himself, has been very friendly, and besides working in his lab in the retina of chickens, trying to unravel the growth message sent by the retina to the sclera, he has helped me with my papers, editing them and answering all the questions he could. After 5 years of this epistolar relation, he suggested that we contact Ian Morgan, and we three developed a friendship and continuous collaboration and discussion about myopia and emmetropization. Bill has his lab at the University of Calgary, Cumming School of Medicine, Calgary, Canada. And now he will tell us what he knows of the mechanism of action of atropine and other drugs for myopia prevention. Go ahead, dear Bill.
Hola. Greetings, ladies and gentlemen, from the great white north of Calgary, Canada. I am a retinal neuroscientist. I am interested mainly in retinal structure and function, especially as they pertain to myopia, and in the use of atropine eye drops to prevent myopia onset and progression. Low-dose atropine, which has become the drug of choice for this, is not completely effective, but it is clear that vision-dependent activity in the retina is critical for emmetropization and myopia prevention. Therefore, the visual environment must be as important for myopia as genetics, and so we need to know how drugs act in the retina to create better therapies. One example of the role of the visual environment is this elegant finding of Rose and others, including my fellow panelist, Professor Morgan. It showed that time spent outdoors is correlated with lower odds of being myopic. This epidemiological study showed that even if children spent a lot of time doing near work, the odds of developing myopia were low, as long as the children spent a lot of time outdoors. Image processing in the retina plays the most important role in causing or preventing myopia. We use animal models to study this because it's difficult and expensive to do controlled experimental studies in human subjects. Specifically, we induce myopia in newly hatched chickens, chicks that are 5 to 10 days old, and use them to study the underlying mechanisms and test possible therapies. One important fact is that blurring vision by putting a diffuser over the eye, as in the cartoon at the lower left, rapidly induces high myopia. This is called form deprivation myopia. The diffuser reduces light intensity reaching the retina by only very little. It doesn't matter, but it blurs the image a lot by removing fine details. So you see that at the beginning, after weeks of treatment, the refractive error here was more than 20 diopters myopic. But removing the diffuser for only a short time every day reduces the amount of myopia, even though the chick sees images degraded by the diffuser for the rest of the 12-hour light period. So image degradation itself is probably not actively promoting the development of myopia. Instead, the eye may just tend to become longer in the absence of normal vision, and emmetropization may require pattern vision to inhibit this abnormal elongation. So many studies have shown that increasing ambient light intensity causes retinal photoreceptors and neural circuits to be light adapted, becoming less sensitive to light overall, but better at detecting fine spatial detail and movement. This suggests that light adaptation in retinal circuitry might be responsible for myopia prevention. This hypothesis is very likely correct. Increasing light intensity stimulates the release of dopamine and nitric oxide in the retina. These agents, in turn, decrease the lateral spread of transmission. That is, they decrease the coupling between cells in the retina. And this should make the retina more sensitive to fine details. And that, in turn, should promote the inhibition of myopia. We tested this in chicks using the optokinetic response, which is a visual following reflex that depends mainly on retinal image processing. Here we used it to show that increasing illumination, going from the blue graph to the red graph, going from dark to light, that increasing illumination causes the retina to be more sensitive to brightness contrast, especially at high spatial frequencies. That is, to make the retina more sensitive to fine details. We also showed that dopamine and nitric oxide affect contrast sensitivity in the cheek retina, similar to the way light does. Here, for example, are the effects of two dopaminergic agonists, also shifting the same way to higher contrast sensitivity and better at higher frequencies, the same way that light does. It's impossible that this effect is mediated by reducing functional coupling between cells in neural circuits in the retina. And this should encourage us to search for anti-myopia drugs that target other mechanisms involved in light adaptation. So our results, like those of others, suggest that the role of outdoor lighting is mainly to make the retina more sensitive to fine spatial detail, which it needs in order to determine that the eye is emmetropic and that further increases in axial length should be stopped. The drug of choice these days for treating human myopia is topical low-dose atropine. That's 0.01 to 0.05%. Atropine is known mainly as a competitor inhibitor of acetylcholine's action at muscarinic receptors. But there is abundant evidence that atropine prevents myopia by some other mechanism, and that atropine can act on other receptors, including adrenergic ones. Recently in my lab, we showed that the adrenergic agonist brimonidine and other alpha-2A agonists prevent myopia in chicks. Other labs have reported similar findings in guinea pigs, so this is not specific to chickens. Topical brimonidine is safe for human use and is widely used for reducing intraocular pressure, so it might be readily adapted and accepted for myopia treatment in children. In conclusion, we have found that increasing environmental light intensity causes release of dopamine and nitric oxide in the retina, and that these agents tune retinal circuitry to finer image details. I believe that this in turn enables the retina to calculate that the eye is emmetropic and to signal that further axial elongation should be prevented. Atropine and probably many other drugs yet to be discovered play important roles in the prevention and treatment of myopia by acting in the retinal circuitry for light adaptation. Certainly much more remains to be learned, but what we have learned so far has created solid foundations on which further studies can build. And finally, I'm happy to acknowledge the support of several granting agencies and the active research contributions of many students and scientist collaborators. And to you, muchas gracias.
Professor Ximing Li works at the Beijing Dongren Eye Center in the Beijing Dongren Hospital in the Capital Medical University of Beijing, China. He's in charge of an incredible prospective study of a big cohort of Chinese children in Anyang, a nearby city, who are followed with cyclorefractions and lens star biometry for many years while they develop myopia. Thanks that he shared this data, we would publish interesting things about myopia and the crystalline lens. He has been in charge of different studies about undercorrection of myopic children. I am glad to have him along this important myopia researches.
Hello everyone, I'm Ximing Li from Beijing Dongren Hospital, Capital Medical University, Beijing, China. Thank you, Raffel, for inviting me to attend the 2020 Myopia Symposium in Argentina. What do we know about myopia? The title of my speech is Novel Spectacles and Contact Lenses for Myopia Control. First, I have no conflict of interest to declare. We all know that our Earth is becoming more and more myopic due to increasing numbers of people with myopia and high myopia. Children have myopia onset at a younger age, but we have few clinically effective methods to cope with myopia and related complications. We do have some interventions. For example, increasing time outdoors, low concentration atropine, and orthokeratology lens have been the first-line recommendations for myopia control. There are also other methods used in children in myopia, but without convincing strong evidence. More importantly, the mechanism involved in most interventions remains unclear, although they have been used widely. Single-vision spectacles lenses are the mostly common pattern for correction of myopia, and used as the control group in most trials, even though it is still conflicting whether children should wear their spectacles in full correction or under correction. We have conducted a randomized controlled trial in 200 children with low myopia by comparing full correction and under correction of 0.5 diopter. At 1 year and a half, there was no statistical significance in myopia progression and axial elongation between two groups. In our Anyang Childhood Eye study, we performed a nested case control study by including 253 myopic children and found that under correction did not accelerate myopic progression compared with full correction. We did another nested case control study comparing uncorrection and full correction of myopia. The findings suggest that myopic defocus by uncorrection slows the progression of myopia in already myopic children, supporting previously findings from animal studies. We also conducted a meta-analysis on multifocal spectacles and found that they could slow myopic progression in children compared with single-vision spectacles, with great effect in Asian children and children with more myopia. In recent years, novel contact lenses are emerging as new methods for myopia control. Here, novel means bifocal, multifocal, progressive, or peripheral addition designs. Currently, most of the effective designs of contact lenses are manufactured in soft flat soft platforms with two different principles, alternating image and simultaneous image. And for simultaneous image designs, concentric and aspheric multifocal contact lenses are two main types, with discrete segmented rings and gradual changes in power from the center to the peripheral of the lens, respectively. In our meta-analysis on novel contact lenses in 2017, we identified 5 randomized control trials and 3 cohort studies. Both concentric ring bifocal and peripheral and multifocal soft contact lenses are effective for controlling children myopia, with an overall myopia control rate of 30 to 50% over 2 years. Compared with the control group, concentric ring bifocal soft contact lenses showed less myopia progression, with a weighted mean difference of 0.31 diopter and less axial elongation, with a weighted mean difference of 0.12 mm at 12 months. Relative to the control group, peripheral and multifocal soft contact lenses showed a weighted mean difference of 0.22 diopter in myopia progression and 0.1 mm in axial elongation at 12 months. In a trial recently published in JAMA, Jeffrey and Associates found that multifocal contact lenses with high at power of 2.5 diopter reduced the myopia progression over 3 years compared with media at the power of 1.5 diopter and single vision contact lenses. The differences, although statistically significant, was 0.16 diopter to 0.46 diopter in refraction, and 0.07 mm to 0.23 mm in axial lens. Note some factors contributing to the effect of novel designs on myopia control in children. For example, optical, ocular, and neural factors. Environmental factors such as time spent on near work and outdoors also contribute to some extent. In a recent study conducted in Chinese children, the authors found that multifocal soft contact lenses increased the total aberrations and high-order aberrations, produced more positive spherical aberration compared with single-vision soft contact lenses. However, it seems that visual acuity, both high contrast and low contrast distance visual acuity, were satisfactory with multifocal soft contact lenses. So far, all over the world, it is estimated that multifocal soft contact lenses represented about 2.3% of all contact lens fit to children, with highest fit rate of about 25% in Austria, and no fit record in Japan, Greece, South Korea, etc. However, considering the large number of candidates for optic correction of myopia in children worldwide, the impact of novel spectacles and contact lenses for myopia applications is undoubtedly increasing. Of course, the treatment should be tailored to each child, and more research is needed for exploring its mechanisms on controlling myopia, and better methods for myopia control. Okay, this is our group related to myopia study on spectacles and lenses. Thank you, everyone. Thank you for listening. Welcome to Beijing, to China, at your convenience.
Well, I'm glad to introduce our moderators. We have prepared some interesting questions for discussion, and I let my friend Andrzej Grichowski from Poland to begin with the presentation of the questions.
Hello to everyone. This is my pleasure to be part of this great symposium. I would like to thank organizers, especially Dr. Yuri Baron. And I have the first question to Professor Rosema. Jos, you studied ocular growth with data of multiple human studies. What could be the clinical application of your research in myopia prevention? Could you comment on that? Yes, please.
I think it's very, very important in the sense that often myopia studies only consider the eye as a black box. So they perform a certain intervention and they look at the refraction only. Many of the studies that were shown today are exceptions to that, but a large deal of the literature really performs some kind of atropine trial or whatever trial, and the only outcome is refraction. And same thing with cataract trials, for example, also refraction and visual acuity. And the problem with that is that you treat the eye as a black box, and that if you really want to understand what's going on, you need to know what's inside that box. A first step would be to know the actual length. That is a very good first step, but with that, you only know the length of the box. And you know whether that's a box that is longer or shorter compared to the average size of the eye. But if you keep in mind that it's possible to have an emmetropic eye that is 26 millimeters long or 21 and a half, it's really important to know the cornea and the lenticular power to understand how that eye comes to that refraction. The actual length itself is not enough. So corneal power is very easily calculated, actual length also. It's the lenticular power that is often the problem. And you can use Bennett's equation and things like that. But I think quite a few people are also hoping for a proper method to actually measure the lenticular power. Hopefully OCT systems can in the future help with that.
Thank you very much. Anybody would like to comment on that? Thank you. I have another question to Professor Kotlik. Carlos, you did a lot of work in the role of hypertension in myopia pathogenesis. What do you think would be the future of this? And what is the present status of hypotensors in myopia pathogenesis?
Well, now we have atropine, very, very diluted, you know, super diluted, I like to call it, because when you say diluted, it looks like not that much. It's 0.01 or 0.05 now. So we can use these drugs very safely now. But I do have some patients, very few of them, which keep on continuing with this elongation of the eye. And I think there we have some possibility, or at least that's what I do. I keep on using dorzolamide. Maybe it will change to brimonidine. It's already been said that streaming said that we can use it as an alpha 2 agonist too. But I know they work. Maybe not as much as atropine, very diluted, but they work. Atropine has in those dilutions have absolutely no collateral effects. That's why I like it. But you gave me the opportunity. I would like to thank all of our great researchers that I said before that have come here today to this symposium in Argentina. I would like to welcome you all, as we wish we could have done this personally, you know, Andre. I want to say that we've received the national interest of the Parliament of the Senate of the Nation of Argentina over the number 2667-20 by the Senator Cobos from here, from Mendoza, and also the provincial interest by the number 92972. And also this symposia is scheduled in the American Academy of Ophthalmology agenda for today. So I think it's been great to have all these researchers and all these people here. And I thank you for your question. And I think there will be maybe some places where you can use hypotensors. Maybe not as hypotensors.
Thank you very much for this comment. I have another question to Professor Wu. from Taiwan, you nicely shown the role of the intervention programs, how we can, by introducing more how we can influence myopia development. Do you think that with this methodology in time, the myopia prevalence will drop in Taiwanese children to less than 20%, for example, like in South America, like in Argentina?
Yes, thank you for your question. I'm very surprising that in Argentina, school children can have 3 hours outdoor activity. So I think the prevalence is very low. But in Taiwan, well, we can see the trend is decreasing every year, about 1% until now, still decreasing. But we hope in the future we can have so low prevalence of myopia, such in Argentina. But in another worry is that due to the pandemic of the COVID-19, school children using more digital device with longer screen time. So maybe it will increase the prevalence and associated with the myopia progression will be more fast. So we have another strategy we needed to help to stop the myopia progression, to not only decrease the prevalence, but also we needed to prevent the population to become high myopia. So it's needed to more widely to use such as atropine or other device to prevent the future high myopia population. And just now I hear about for the intraocular pressure control, maybe another target. But if you're using the bromelain, this drug is agonist. The drug is using in the glaucoma patients, and some patients will complain that they were a little bit drowsy, especially for the children. We should be more careful because it will cross the BBB, the blood-brain barrier. So maybe we needed to search for other other drugs did not across the BBB maybe benefit for the children. So it should be a little bit cautious. So thank you for your question.
Thank you very much. Now I would like to ask Professor Cohen, you nicely presented the correlation between the indoor illuminance and the refractive error. So do you think that having in mind your studies, there should be some new recommendations for indoor illumination introduced or updated?
Thank you for the question. So the first question should be addressed, what is considered to be myopia in nursery school? It's probably not on the myopic or minus side, but probably on the hyperopic side. Maybe we'll see at the age of 4 years plus 0.5 and we can call it myopia and the infant interventions should be started then. The second, what should we do about the indoor light levels? I think that, of course, we have to do a bigger study that probably have to understand what are the really interval between the hyperopic to the myopic transition and what is the light intensity then that we can correlate with. And then we can say we have something that we can do about the light. I think that we are far away from that, especially because we don't have any rules or regulation in our country or maybe in other countries to control the light. And we have no access, actually. It's very difficult to intervene inside a kindergarten because they mostly are private and it's a legal issue that could be that we could probably face. That's it also was a difficult study to access a kindergarten. It was a probably we had to ask the parents for the permission. Very young age, we had to examine them, and we had to explain why. And I think that something like that should be coming. With time, with as a rule for the child safety, and we had to explain probably in a regular or maybe governmental levels to begin with.
Thank you. And from my side, the last question is to Professor Ian Morgan. Your work during the last 20 years showed that school myopia epidemics is mainly environmental. Do you think that clinical ophthalmologists can do something to prevent development or more to avoid high myopia? What is your opinion?
Please, Ian, unlock your microphone.
Ian, put your microphone on.
It's in the, if you move the mouse, you will find a button.
On the lower left of your screen.
Okay, let's continue until you can unlock your
microphone. Okay, fine. Yeah. Can you hear me now?
Yeah. Please.
Yes. Okay. The problem was I was getting a message saying only the host can unmute. Okay. Now back to the question. Yeah. Obviously, the main focus for clinicians is going to be in controlling progression. You can make recommendations to patients about time outdoors, and that will have some effect. But for time outdoors to be most effective, it seems to me that it has to be implemented within the school systems. Singapore has had an emphasis directed to parents about getting children outdoors, and I have to tell you that it's made almost no difference because the pressures on parents are such that they don't have the time or take the time to get their children outdoors more. So parental education is not enough. And the simplest way to deal with this when you need it is to implement it in the schools. Now, I think we can take a lesson from the approach to COVID. What the World Health Organization says is go early and go hard. And I think we have to concentrate our efforts on the early years of primary school. Remember in China, 50% of kids are myopic by the end of primary school. If we can stop them becoming myopic up until that stage, they may later become myopic, but they certainly won't proceed to become highly myopic unless they're genetically disposed to that. So concentrate on the primary schools, get children outside more, and also reduce educational pressures. I don't know if Raphael made this point in his talk, but one of the things about, I've seen some of his data, which shows that in Argentina, children get outside a lot more, but they also have very much shorter school days than you get in East Asia. And there seems to be less intense pressure in the early years. I think to address another question that was put to Pei Chan, I think in order to get really effective to control, to bring the prevalence of myopia in Taiwan down to levels that would be more typical of Western countries, time outdoors is one part of the equation, but you also have to look at the other side, which is reducing educational pressures. Now, that's not a matter that's under the control of clinicians. Obviously, you can make recommendations to parents, but once again, any parent wants their child to succeed, so they'll operate within the parameters that are set. So it seems to me this is a matter that once again has to be controlled within the schools and within education systems. And the roles for clinicians here are to point out to the appropriate authorities that we have to do something to reduce educational pressures on kids, particularly in the early years. And if we do both of those, then I think we can bring the prevalence of myopia dramatically down all across East Asia and Singapore.
Thank you very much.
Yeah, let me ask you a question that somebody of the audience is asking. What do you think about reading and the difference between reading and cell phones and computers? Do you think that computers and cell phones are also important in this myopia development, or the evidence is not so strong?
Well, look, I think at the moment the evidence is not strong. There's certainly no particular evidence that cell phones, mobile phones, computer screens are actually dangerous in themselves. They may contribute to the near work reading load, however that translates into myopia is, I think, still a bit unclear. But I think the best way to look at computers at the moment is to consider them a component of near work. Now, that raises some questions. Taiwan, for example, has put some limits, legal limits, on the amount of time that young children can use computers. But if you're simply stopping kids using computers and they're going back to reading books, will you gain anything from this? On the present evidence, I would say no, we really should concentrate on getting total near work down, particularly in the early years, and getting kids outside more.
Thank you, Ian. Thank you very much. Well, André, thank you for all these questions we had programmed. And now I give the word to Calvin Pang from Hong Kong, so he can ask the other audience another questions. I must say that Bill Stell, my good friend, could not log in, and I will call him afterwards to see what happens. So he's okay, not.
Thanks, Rafael. Very, very impressive talks and presentations, and all those experts on special topics, right? And really very impressive. And so I'd like to direct some questions. Most of these questions, some are from, you know, given to me, some are from our own, are more sort of practical in sense of dealing with, you know, myopia. So Professor Frank Schiffel, the on and off mechanism, right? So do you think reading with off contrast would help to slowing down myopia progression? I mean, put it into a more sort of practical perspective. Frank?
Yes, I'm here now. Can you hear me?
Yes, sure. Yeah.
Very good. The whole assumption rests on the fact that we assume that thicker choroids cause less axial eye growth. And if this would stand up in our experiments, then definitely reading bright text on a dark background will or should slow down axial eye growth. I must confess, we have not yet done a study in children where children either read normal text or inverted text. This is really missing and needs to be done in the future because only then people will finally believe it. I only can add that we have repeated with different text sizes the same experiments with inverted text, and the effects on choroids stand up for certain sizes of letters. If you make them very small, it doesn't work, but it works in the intermediate range. So I think the link between choroidal thickness and inverted text is kind of confirmed by our recent studies. Anyway,
yeah, that's very logical. Right. Well, we look forward to the more study in your data, Frank. Right?
Yeah.
It's so important for your experiment to translate, you know, from animal to chick model that you discovered it now, showing it in children. So that's great, right?
Yeah.
Right. So I have to move on. Dr. Virginie Van Hoven. Virginie, we all know about your work. I know about your work on the genetic side. Your big data sets and then horrendous amount of work in great details. Now, Virginie, now with these 500 gene variants association with myopia, there's still no, you know, genetic test, or of course hoping for polygenic genetic markers. And you don't think that they are useful to sort of predict myopia, Virginie?
No, I think there are different opinions on this, but from our side in Erasmus Medical Center, we are not using it in clinic because, as I mentioned, the actual length growth curves are the most important predictor for high myopia. But of course, in children with early onset high myopia or in children with other symptoms, so with other ocular symptoms or with systemic involvement, there is indeed a indication to do DNA examination. So in these children, we perform whole exome sequencing, and actually in the very early onset high myopia cases, so as a rule of thumb, we use a high myopia in which the refractive error exceeds the age of the child. So in these children, we do the whole exome sequencing. And in our study, we have now done 75 children with this indication. And in 1 in 5 children, we can really find a strong genetic factor for this myopia. So a syndromic form of myopia. And if you look at these groups of children, you can distinguish patients with retinal dystrophies, for which high myopia is the first symptom, but also children with connective tissue diseases such as Stickler syndrome or Knobloch syndrome, as well as non-syndromic high myopia genes such as the Arrestin-3 gene. So, of course, there's an indication in that particular group which should be taken into account.
Yeah, that's what I'm after, Virginie, at the early onset. Now, I'm absolutely with you on the, you know, exo length growth curves. They're definitely useful. However, when, you know, a child 6 years old come to your clinic, you know, with already, you know, 2-3 doctors, you know, with great potential to develop heart myopia, the parents of course want to know sort of genetic background, right?
Yeah.
And then you mentioned about, you know, the syndromic, of course, you know, that could be helped by exome sequencing, but mostly it could be non-syndromic. Right? So that's hard.
Yes. Yes, it's still hard. But so, as mentioned, we don't offer genetic testing. So one of the easiest things is to just ask the parents whether they have myopia or not, which is also a very important predictor, and then do a extensive ophthalmological workup. And that, as Ian already mentioned, we prescribe them the 20-22 rule, so to be outside a lot and to do not as many near work as they should do. So that's the most important thing that we do, besides of atropine treatment, of course.
Yes. Calvin, please, let me say something. In the Marcos Suarez study, the progression in 5 children who were highly prone to high myopia at baseline when they were 6 years old, in 5 years with the outdoor exposure they have in Marcos Juarez, they had a mean progression of 1.5 diopters only in 5 years. So I'm sure that also in genetic cases, outdoors can be helpful.
Can be, yeah.
Yeah, I agree, Rafael. Thanks.
So on that, we come to atropine, right? So, Virginie knows what I'm thinking about, prophylactic treatment of atropine is prophylactic, isn't it? So Jason, okay, right? Now, Virginia recommend no really, genetic test may help, right, to predict. But then children come to you, Jason, right? And again, minus six, right, too much sleep already at 6 years old, you would prescribe atropine, would you, Jason? And not quite, as that sort of refractory error. So Jason, what would be your treatment to children when they come to you like that?
Thank you very much, Professor Peng, and all the panel, and especially thank you for allowing me to share some of our experience. And I want to also reply to Virginie's comment on the genetic test. As of now, there's no genetic test for myopia yet. What we are doing is based on parental myopia. In our Hong Kong Children Eye Study, we have 2,000 trio family with both parents' data and children data. And then we do analysis and found that both highly myopic parents have an odd ratio of having children develop myopia at the age of 6 to 8. The odd ratio is 12. After adjusting outdoor activity, reading time, environmental lifestyle. So in our analysis, the parental myopia is one of the single most important predictor for myopia development. So going back to Professor Pan's question, and also I can see in the chat group, a lot of people are also interested to share about how to use atropine. In our humble experience, for me, number one, the age of onset is important. Number two, the parental myopia is important. And also in our recent data, we also showed that atropine, the most important predictor for the treatment response is also age. The younger the age, the higher myopia progression and the less treatment response. And across different treatment concentration, I would suggest for young children, if they have young age of onset of myopia, use higher concentration. You need to use higher concentration to aggressively reduce the myopia progression in order to reduce the risk of becoming highly myopia. Because the younger age of onset of myopia, the higher, much higher risk of becoming highly myopia. So this is one of our approach. So we will start from 0.05% for the age of 6 if they come to us. Conversely, for those of older children, for example, age of 12, age of 14, they already start to slow down the myopia progression, and and those are the lower risk. And we can consider lower concentration, say for example, 0.025 or 0.01%. The range between 0.05% and 0.025% and 0.01% is roughly about 2 years. That means at the age of 6, you use 0.05, the efficacy is similar to those you use 0.025 at age of 8, and similar to those you use 0.01% at age of 10. So age effect on the concentration also. So this is some of our humble experience to share. Thank you very much, Professor Peng.
Well, that's impressive, Jason. Very meticulous, right, on treatment of children, right? And then you consider age, and then and you already have a nice protocol, right? I want to come back to the question, not the point of parental influence, right? Yeah, parental myopia affecting children. But then the influence might not be genetic, might not be biological, it's equally lifestyle, right? That is passed on this lifestyle near work and less outdoor activities to children. So that's also, we can say environmental, I would say, is lifestyle. That's also passing on from parent to children. And I do want to find out eventually, with this gene variants that we have found, and Virginia is working on this huge data sets, that still there have to be some, hopefully, some gene variants that can pass on affecting children from their parents. And so there's still a lot of work to do on that. However, right now, we are still wanting to help the children, and Professor Ximing Li has been working on that. And the orthokeratology and the know, the focal spectacles, the focused contact lens. Now we have this atropine. So Xiuming, what would be your, you know, a preference, right? When children come to you with different sort of levels of myopia, different age, or young children, right? What would be your preference or in your treatment with this whole list, you know, of possible devices nowadays?
Thank you, Professor Pang. Yeah, I think the question is very challengeable for every doctor working on myopia control in children. And it's also interesting for most parents with children. As we all know, China has the biggest population of myopia in children, and maybe the highest rate of myopia prevalence in the world. It's a big challenge for how to control myopia in children in today's China, especially in the bigger cities such as Beijing, Shanghai. We do have some choices, as you mentioned, atropine, contact lenses, also character lenses, and maybe defox spectacles to control myopia in children. Although the mechanisms involved in each option is still unclear, but we can choose the currently best option for each child based on evidence-based medicine. In my opinion, increasing time outdoors is suitable for all children, especially for those children without myopia, such as preschool children. Atropine has been proved to be effective in controlling myopia progression in children by many trials, such as the trial by Jason, the trial in Singapore, and the trial in our hospital. So I think the atropine 0.0.1 atropine can be used as the initial concentration for myopia children. Of course, it can be changed to a higher concentration, such as 0.025% or 0.05% for children if the myopia correction is still significant after the atropine has been used. But note that the higher concentration of atropine may rise significant side effects such as photophobia or blurred vision due to the cyclopegic effect. So maybe, you know, for the higher concentration of atropine is not suitable for some myopia children. So we should consider the specific conditions for each children. And as for orthocolitrology lens, it is more popular than defox spectacles or defox contact lenses in China. And defox spectacles have the advantages of convenience and safe than contact lenses. However, it seems that the effect of defox spectacles is weak than defox contact lenses. You know, so I think, in my opinion, I will consider the specific condition of each child when the child comes to my clinic. And sometimes I will use the combination of two or more treatments for child. For example, atropine and also keratology lens, and maybe atropine and defox spectacle lens. So I think we should treat the children in personalized medicine. You know, that's my personal views. Thank you.
Oh, thanks, Xiuming. Very precious experiences. You know?
Thank you.
So it's not easy, right? Treating children, and then it's such an epidemic, right? And I, of course, always hope that, you know, the genetic work can help, and then Virginia and team is working, you know, very intensely on that, and then hopefully the Hong Kong data and with this data set that we are building up, Chinese in Hong Kong, you know, urbanized city can also contribute to genetic testing. But it's all for treatment. Treatment is not easy. So thank you, Xiuming, and all our clinicians for sharing our experiences. So our discussion can go on and on, right? But then there's a limit in time. So I'd like to hand over the time back to Rafael. Thanks.
Thank you, Professor Calvin Pan. We are just in time to finish, but there's a question from my friend who who is listening to us, Gabriela Rodriguez, who likes to counsel her patients about good nutrition. So I would like to ask the panel if they know about any investigation about nutrition and myopia. Is there somebody who wants to speak about this?
Well, I'm happy to say something here because I've just been doing a review of the literature. There are some old papers which make suggestions, but I think the most relevant one of in recent days comes from Singapore. And what they've found is that they see an effect of nutrition on axial length in young children. These are children up to the age of about six. They're following them through for much longer. They see an effect of nutrition on axial length, but they see no effect of nutrition on spherical equivalent. So that nutrition affects overall growth, if you like, but what we can call emmetropization takes care of that to make sure that there's no myopia under normal circumstances.
Okay, I agree with you, Ian, and thank you very much. I know taller people and men have bigger eyes than women and no difference in refractive error.
So very often less.
Well, to finish, I would like...
It's 2 a.m. Yeah. in Australia. Just wanted to point out that. Thank you, Ian, very much. For you, it's 2 a.m. Thank you.
Okay. To finish, I would say that a personal experience. When I was studying medicine and was 18, I developed a low myopia of 0.5, 0.75, and I was asking myself, why is this happening? Does it have something to do with reading? Now, 40 years later, we know that it's a combination of low outdoor exposure, reading probably black letters in white background, and the lack of accommodation that makes the focus in my eyes when I am reading. So to finish, I would like to thank Fernando Guzman, who made all the publishing from the CAO, Deborah Pacheta, his secretary, Sergio Eppelbaum, who is hearing us and transmitting, Estela Herrera and his friend who has translated this to Spanish, and Federico Arroyo, my son-in-law, who made the video, the nice video for the presentation. So I leave you with Argentine folk mass music. Sergio, please play the video of my friend Rolando Goldman, who plays the charango. And thank you, all of you, for being here.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.